طيب يعني
بالظبط.
الحقيقة أحرجتوني بالتقدمة اللي أنا لا أستحقها، فأنا
العفو يا فندم.
أبلغ يعني شكري وامتناني للكلام اللطيف اللي أنتوا قلتوه ده. It's a great honor and great pleasure to participate in this webinar with the Orthopedic Department of our sister university, Banha University, جامعة العظام العظماء. وبشكر دكتور أسامة حجازي، دكتور محمد الأشهب، دكتور عماد، دكتور أحمد علام على الدعوة الجميلة، ويا رب دايما نكون مع بعض، وأتمنى تكون البرزنتيشن بينيفيشال لينا كلنا بإذن الله. This presentation is about the skipped capital femoral epiphysis and its topic is management of this pathological entity in the hip impingement era. We have been treating slip capital femoral epiphysis by various techniques in the past 20 years in our department in Shams University, trying every possible and every mentioned technique in the literature. Like 7 years or 8 years ago, we have decided to reach a management algorithm that tells us which technique and which procedure to be done in every single case, based on the current evidence of literature. We'll start this presentation by this case. This is a 12 years old boy who presented to the emergency department with knee pain and inability to weight bear after falling from a bike, and that was his X-ray. And this is another case of 14 years old, this time presented to the outpatient clinic, not the emergency department, with a complaint of a painful limb. On examination, he had limited hip flexion and internal rotation, and that's his X-ray. And this differs from this X-ray of a 14 years old male presented to the outpatient clinic with painful limb. There was an obvious external rotational deformity, and on examination also there was limited hip flexion and internal rotation. While this is another boy, 14 years old, also presented to the outpatient clinic with a painful limb and the external rotation deformity was limited hip flexion and internal rotation, exactly like the previous case, but that was his X-ray, which is completely different from the previous one. So the objective of this talk is to present our department's algorithm for management cases of slip capital femoral epiphysis based on our experience and the best available evidence in the literature. And this has been published in the SICO journal in 2017, and currently have been cited in 3 major articles in Orthopedic Clinic of North America, Hip International, and other prestigious journals. To start this presentation, we need to talk about what actually do we know about slip capital femoral epiphysis. We know that slip capital femoral epiphysis, as we have seen from these cases, it has diverse mode of presentation. And also we know that slips can progress. So you can have a mild slip today and next 6 months it's moderate slip and then it becomes severe slip. So there is diverse mode of presentation and there is possibility of progression from mild degree to severe degree. This is for sure and we all know that. So this is an unstable slip capital femoral epiphysis. This is a stable but mild slip capital femoral epiphysis in a child with open physis, and this is a stable moderate slip capital femoral epiphysis in a closing physis, and that is a severe and stable slip capital femoral epiphysis, but the proximal femoral epiphysis is widely open. What are the differences between these cases? Can these cases managed by the same operative technique, do they have the same long-term and short-term outcome of treatment? First, second, we need to know, what do we know about this AVN? We know that AVN is the most dreadful complication in the treatment of slip capital femoral epiphysis. And in the literature, when they compared the incidence of AVN with hip slip stability, slip degree, and the treatment timing or the treatment method, it was found that the incidence of AVN is solely related to hip stability. And in many reports, in unstable slip capital femoral epiphysis, the AVN approaches 50% just because it was unstable, disregarding the slip degree, when it was treated, and what treatment method was accomplished. What we know again, we know that Slipped capital femoral epiphysis for sure leads to femoroacetabular impingement, which is now recognized as a definite precursor for hip osteoarthritis. So first we have a slip, and the slip remodels to cause a pistol grip deformity that causes femoroacetabular impingement, and on the long run, in 40s or 50s, it leads to osteoarthritis. And what was regarded before as primary osteoarthritis was traced to previous childhood pathology of mild slip capital femoral epiphysis with pistol grip deformity. And the cause of osteoarthritis in these cases is due to the proven and reported labral injuries and common chondral injuries that are commonly associated with this deformity. What do we know again? We know that for quite sure that the most accepted treatment method for slip capital femoral epiphysis is in situ pinning. And we are sure that in situ pinning alone does not guarantee satisfactory long-term outcome. And that long-term outcome is very important because eventually it would lead to needing a total hip replacement. So to summarize the literature, slip capital femoral epiphysis has diverse modes of presentation and it can progress. In unstable slip capital femoral epiphysis, the incidence of AVN approaches 50% and it is related to the instability alone, disregarding of other factors. We know that slip capital femoral epiphysis causes femoroacetabular impingement, and that's a definite precursor for osteoarthritis. Therefore, when we are aiming for treatment, the aim of treatment is threefold. First, we need to stop progression. Second, we need to prevent AVN on the short term, and we need to prevent osteoarthritis on the long term. If your treatment aim is missing one of them, then your treatment is incomplete. So you need to stop progression, prevent AVN in short term, and prevent osteoarthritis on the long term. In our organism, when we see a case of slip capital femoral epiphysis, we need to answer four queries or four questions. First, we need to know, is it a stable slip capital femoral epiphysis or it is an unstable? And we need to comment on the degree of slip. Is it mild, moderate, or severe? Then we need to answer this question. Is it causing a clinical impingement or not? Then we need to assess, is the physis mature or immature? Has the physis approached closure or closed, or it is still yet open? These are very important questions that we need to answer for our decision making. If we are talking about stability, how can we define a stability of slip capital femoral epiphysis? The most important thing is clinical instability, which is inability to weight bear even with scratches. There is no other way to define stability but clinically by inability to weight bear even with scratches. If the patient can weight bear with scratches, this is a stable slip capital femoral epiphysis. If the patient cannot bear weight completely even with scratches, this is unstable. And for these particular unstable cases, we do SCR, that's subcapital realignment of the head by surgical hip dislocation as soon as possible within 24 hours, because we are simply treating this case as a transphyseal femoral neck fracture. Let's explain this further. First, you can tell me that if you do surgical dislocation, you are increasing the incidence of AVN. While the literature has reported that the incidence of deep AVN is not related to the operative technique, but related to the instability. So AVN is related to own instability, not the treatment method. The second thing, there is a rare entity being a genuine unstable slipped capital femoral epiphysis is really a rare entity. Why is that? Because usually, even in these unstable cases, we see a posterior callus. So maybe it's an acute traumatic episode on top of an old slip, or it could be a really stable slip and the pain is due to synovitis from the resulting impingement. So it is very rare to have a true unstable slip capital femoral epiphysis because simply it's a transphyseal femoral neck fracture, not an unstable slip capital femoral epiphysis. And how the AVN does happen? It happens because of the tamponade effect from the effect of hemoarthrosis or effusion, and due to vessel kinking from the acute displacement of the head, and due to callus stretch, and especially if you do unintended reduction. And these can be reversed completely by subcapital realignment by surgical hip dislocation. Moreover, if you do a subcapital realignment by surgical hip dislocation, you unkink the vessel, you decompress the capsule, and you remove the even the posterior callus if it is present. So you are protecting the vascularity, not disturbing the vascularity, but you have to be professional in the procedure. And you are providing, using the physeal instability and mobility in the acute cases to facilitate forceless reduction. And you are providing perfect anatomical realignment at the apex of the deformity, exactly. That's our rationale in doing subcapital realignment or the modified done procedure. The second question we need to ask, if the patient is stable, when is the patient stable? When the patient can weight bear even with crutches. That's a stable slip capital femoral epiphysis. And if it's stable, we ask the second question. What is the degree of displacement? And we measure the degree of displacement by the percentage of epiphyseal displacement on the metaphysis. And we call this the lateral slip angle. Simply, we don't divide it as mild to moderate and severe. And we have a rationale behind this. We just classify the degree according to mild if it is less than 30 degrees lateral slip angle, and moderate to severe when it is just more than 30 degrees. And I'll tell you that since all slips can progress, therefore insight to pinning is mandatory to stop progression even in mild cases. Then we ask ourselves the third question, do we have a clinical impingement or not? We need to know that mild slip capital femoral epiphysis can be impinging, but it cannot be impinging. Not all mild cases are impinging. But if you have a moderate to severe slip capital femoral epiphysis, this is always an impinging pathology. That's why we divide these cases into mild, then moderate and severe, because mild can be impinging, but moderate and severe and always impingement. And in impinging slips, insight to pinning is very important to stop the progression, but actually it cannot prevent the long-term outcome of osteoarthritis because there is impingement that will lead to chondral and labral injuries and osteoarthritis on the long term. How does this happen? We have two types of impingement in slip capital femoral epiphysis. We have the impaction type and the inclusion type. In the impaction type, before remodeling, you have the peak of the metaphysis impinging against the edge of the acetabulum, and it causes labral tears, which is a pre-arthritic condition. And after remodeling happens, we have an additional inclusion type because part of the metaphysis will articulate with the hyaline cartilage of the hip. And if you have a hyaline cartilage articulating with a bone, that leads to osteoarthritis. So we have impaction type and inclusion type impingement, and these has different, these are different pathologies that needs different way of treatment. So what if it is stable and mild slip capital femoral epiphysis? We said before that it could be impinging or non-impingement. And how to detect if it's impinging or not? That's clinically. If hip flexion is less than or equal 90 degrees, and when internal rotation is less than or equal 15 degrees, this means that this hip has a mild slip with impingement. So if it's non-impingement, what we do, we need to stop the progression, but we don't have to worry about impingement. So we just do insight to pinning. But if it is an impinging mild slip, we need to stop progression and relieve the femoroacetabular impingement. So we have to associate insight to pinning with osteochondroplasty. And whether you can do it with hip arthroscopy, mini open approach, or surgical hip dislocation, this is depend on the experience and the preference of the operating surgeon. So on the short term, you have prevented progression by insight to pinning and prevented the long-term expected bad long-term outcome by doing an osteochondroplasty. That's for mild slip. What if it is moderate or severe, which means that the lateral slip angle more than 30 degrees and it is stable? This is an always impinging slip. And whenever you do your clinical examination, you'll always find limited flexion and limited internal rotation more than 50 degrees. Then our management will depend on the state of the physeal maturity, and I'll explain that in a moment. How to assess the state of physeal maturity and whether it is closing or open? We do a CT scan and X-ray. And depending on the result, if we have a stable, moderate, and severe slip capital femoral epiphysis that is impingement, but the physis is still open, we need to stop the progression and relieve the femoroacetabular impingement, as we said before. And if it's the physis is closed already or approaching closure, this means that it is non-progressive slip and that it is stabilizing itself. So we don't need to stabilize this physis. We just only want to relieve the femoroacetabular impingement to prevent the late onset of osteoarthritis. How can we accomplish that? We can stop, we can relieve the femoroacetabular impingement in severe cases by subcapital realignment, by surgical hip dislocation, and that's known as the modified Dunn's procedure. But if the physis is open, this procedure will be very easy because you have a line of cleavage along the cartilage of the physis, and you can easily separate the head and realign it to the metaphysis after removal of the posterior remodeling. So the subcapital realignment becomes easy and with low risk of AVN as Dunn explained in its original publication. But when the physis is closed or closing, if you are doing the physial separation, you are doing an intra-articular osteotomy of the head-neck junction, and this is very dangerous as highlighted by original Dunn approach. And this is very dangerous with high incidence of AVN, and this is what Dunn's called cuneiform osteotomy. So how to relieve the femoroacetabular impingement when you have a severe or moderate slip capital femoral epiphysis that is stable and the physis is closed or closing? Would you do an osteochondroplasty like in mild cases, or you would approach it by intertrochanteric osteotomy? Let's analyze these two procedures according to the effect. If you do an osteochondroplasty alone in a slip capital femoral epiphysis that's moderate to severe and the physis is closed, you will relieve the impaction and the inclusion impingement. But to do that, you will need to do excess neck trimming, and this might lead to femoral neck fracture. But you cannot align the thick cartilage of the femoral head to the central cartilage of the acetabulum. And that's the healthy cartilage. That's the cartilage that can withstand the normal loads of the head. So you have relieved the impaction, including impingement, but you haven't aligned the thick cartilage of the top of the head to the central weight-bearing dome of the acetabulum. And if you do an intertrochanteric osteotomy alone, you cannot relieve the impaction and the inclusion impingement, but you can succeed to realign the thick cartilage of the head. If you are going to do both, you need to associate osteochondroplasty with intertrochanteric osteotomy, which is the Imhauser or the modified Imhauser osteotomy. If you do that, you will succeed to relieve the impaction and the inclusion impingement, and you will succeed to realign the thick cartilage of the head. And based on this, in stable, moderate to severe slip capital femoral epiphysis, while the physis is closed or approaching closure, we associate osteochondroplasty with intertrochanteric osteotomy in the form of modified Imhauser, as in this technique. And how we do that? You can do that in two separate sessions, or you can do that in the same session. But our technique is to do that in the same session. And we do that by surgical hip dislocation, by Gans approach in the lateral position, and we do the intertrochanteric osteotomy and can relieve the impaction impingement by doing an osteochondroplasty at the same time. We do it in the lateral position, and this has recently been published in the Journal of Children's Orthopedic by our hip preservation team. So in moderate and severe slip capital femoral epiphysis, when the physis is approaching maturity or it is already mature, we do not use subcapital realignment because it is a very dangerous procedure with high incidence of AVN. We do it only when the physis is open because we have a clear line of demarcation that allows us to realign the capital epiphysis without much damage to the blood supply in agreement with the original Dunn's publication. So to sum up our talk, this is our algorithm that has been published. You have a case of slip capital femoral epiphysis, you need to answer four queries. Is it stable or unstable? If it is unstable, that's an entity. If it's stable, then we ask the second question. Is it mild or moderate to severe? Depending on the lateral slip angle from the frog lateral view, if it is less than 30, it is mild. If it is more than 30, then it is either moderate or severe. We don't care about the difference between moderate and severe. Why? Because both of them are impinging and must be impinging and will lead to long-term consequence of osteoarthritis. Then we ask ourselves finally, is this physis open or it is closed or closing? If it is closed or approaching closure, that's an issue. If it is open, we do a different procedure. So if it is unstable, we do modified done procedure, which is subcapital realignment by surgical hip dislocation approach. If it is stable, then we ask the second question. Is it mild or moderate to severe? If it is mild, then we ask the third question. Is it a mild impinging slip or mild non-impinging slip? If it is a non-impinging slip, then the management, the aim of management is to stop the progression of this mild slip into moderate or severe slip. So we stop the progression by doing in situ fixation and that's it. But when it is impingement, we cannot do in situ fixation alone because we will stop the progression, but we will leave the impingement that will lead to osteoarthritis due to chondral and labral damage. So we have to associate in situ fixation with osteochondroplasty at the same time. Either we do it mini open or arthroscopic or through surgical hip dislocation according to the experience of the operating surgeon. So if it is moderate to severe, it doesn't matter so long as the angle is more than 30 because it must be impingement. We never ask the third question. So we ask the fourth question. Is it, do we have an open physis or do we have a closed physis? If we have an open physis, this means that we can safely perform subcapital realignment by surgical hip dislocation, which is the modified Duns procedure. We can safely do that with minimal instance of AVN because we have an open physis that we can separate the head and realign it to the neck with minimal injury to the blood supply. But if the physis is closed, we never do this procedure because it is very dangerous. So how do we manage the impingement in moderate to severe cases with closed devices? We have to associate intertrochanteric osteotomy in the form of modified Imhauser by osteochondroplasty. Some people do it in two separate sessions. Some do it in the same session in the supine position by doing a lateral approach, Watson-Jones, and some do it combined it the lateral approach with mini open anterior approach. We simply do it through lateral approach. We surgically dislocate the hip and trim the cam impingement. And then at the same time, from the lateral approach, we do a modified Duns approach as I have explained. So let's get back to our cases to see how we manage different modes of presentation. So this is a 12 years old boy, fell from a bike, and he came to the emergency department with knee pain and ability weight bearing. You cannot differentiate this kind of slip with a transphyseal neck pain. So we need to ask the four queries. Is it a stable slip? The patient cannot weight bear, so it is unstable. We don't ask further questions. If it is unstable, then the instance of AVN is related to this injury itself, disregarding the type of treatment as mentioned in the literature, and we do subcapital realignment by surgical hip dislocation, and that's the post-operative X-ray after 3 months. And back to the 14 years old, he came walking to the outpatient clinic with just painful limb. And on examination, he has limited flexion and internal rotation. So let's do our queries. Is it a stable slip capital femoral epiphysis? Yes, it is stable because the patient came weight bearing even with crutches. What is the degree of slip? We measure the lateral slip angle. If it is less than 30 degrees, this is a mild slip, as obvious from the X-ray. So the third question to be asked, is this mild slip causing clinical impingement? Yes, it is causing clinical impingement because it is limited hip flexion and internal rotation. Then we need to ask, is the physis mature or not? So in this case, this is a stable, mild slip capital femoral epiphysis. If it is non-impingement, we need to stop the progression by in situ pinning alone. But this is the impingement. So we need to associate in situ pinning with osteochondroplasty. Again, mini open surgical hip dislocation or through surgical hip arthroscopy. And that's what we have done in this case, only pinning in situ and osteochondroplasty because it was an impinging mild slip. Back to this case, 14 years old, came with painful limp with obvious external rotation deformity. This is obviously more than mild slip capital femoral epiphysis. It is moderate to severe type. And the patient has limited hip flexion and internal rotation. If you do just pinning in situ, then you have stopped the progression. It's already going into severe, but you have not managed the impaction and the other type of impingement. If you don't manage this impingement, you have committed this hip to late osteoarthritis. So you need to stop the progression and you need to prevent osteoarthritis. So what about stability? Patient came to the outpatient clinic, weight bearing with pain. So this is a stable slip capital femoral epiphysis. What about the degree? Definitely the lateral slip angle is more than 30. So it is moderate to severe slip capital femoral epiphysis. Is it impingement? Yes, definitely it is impingement. And the second question, is the physis closed or open or closing? Apparently I can see a clear line of demarcation because the physis is still open. So in this case, I can easily pass a curved osteotome to separate this capital epiphysis from the metaphysis and realign it to the metaphysis. So this is a stable sphere with open physis, and we do subcapital realignment by surgical hip dislocation, attacking the deformity at its apex. And that's what we have done in this case. So our last case, 14 years old, presented with painless limb with external rotation deformity. And he has limited flexion and internal rotation. Pretty much it's like the previous case, except that two things. The slip is moderate, but it doesn't matter if it's moderate in severe. How about the physis? I can judge on the X-ray and confirm by the CT that the physis is blurred. It is a closing physis. And if I try to attempt realignment of this head by surgical hip dislocation using a modified Down procedure, I have a high risk of the AVN based on the literature and our true experience in Inchams University. So it is stable and it is moderate and definitely causing clinical impingement. And the last question is the physis closed or closing or open? It is a closing physis. And I cannot do surgical hip dislocation, as I told you. So how to relieve the impingement? I combine the osteochondroplasty with intertrochanteric osteotomy in the same session. And that's the X-ray after healing of the osteotomy. So we have relieved the impaction impingement and the inclusion impingement without much trimming of the femoral neck. And we have corrected the deformity, but unfortunately we have to correct the deformity away from its apex by this osteotomy, but we cannot do otherwise because the physis was already closing. And if you do subcapital realignment to attack the osteotomy at its apex, you have high incidence of AVN by your own hand. And that's it. Thank you very much for listening.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much, Dr. Mahmoudi. يعني على ال very nice and interesting talk, يا فندم.
Thank you.
Thank you.
أعتقد أن نيوزيلاند دكتور محمود عرض هاي السيريتيكال باك جراوند والكلينيكال كيس برزنتيشن الاثنين هايلين بصراحة تسلم إيديك.
دكتور أحمد. أعتقد أن إحنا عندنا وقت ناخد كم سؤال يا دكتور أحمد.
عندنا وقت أكيد يا فندم. دكتور عماد.
ما حضرتك يا فندم؟
اديني الاسئله لو سمحت.
هبص عليها دلوقتي يا فندم. هو بس كان في سؤال شخصي ليا دكتور احمد، بس عايز اساله الدكتور محمود بعد اذن حضرتك.
اتفضل.
انا في بعض الحالات، حالات السليب كابيتال فيمورال ابيفيزز، ازاي افرق الامبنجمنت؟ ممكن يكون في سم سورت اوف مسل سبازم او بين للتشايلد، فانا ازاي افرق الميكانيكال امبنجمنت فروم البيولوجيكال كوز اوف limited range of motion of the hips.
Both Dr. Ahmed, thank you for your nice question. But usually if you have a chronic slip, for example, and it is stable and the patient is weight bearing, usually you don't have muscle spasm. You can have synovitis, yes, but you can elicit limited flexion and internal rotation. And if the slip is moderate or severe, it is impinging by default. You don't need to do even a clinical test because moderate is impingement. You can ask this question in mild cases. Sometimes it is difficult to tell whether this mild slip is really impingement and causing problems or not. but you can get away from this muscle spasm and other periarticular tissues of the hip. I repeated clinical examination when the child is calm. You can really detect if he really complains of limited flexion and internal rotation. But in mild cases, you are right. It is hard to differentiate. But in moderate to severe, it is impinging by default, and you need to manage the impingement, as we said.
تمام يا دكتور محمود شكرا جزيلا هبص كده يا فندم على الشات بوكس
اتفضل يا دكتور محمود دكتور عماد
وفي اول سؤال في سؤال من الدكتور محمد احمد بليز كان يو اكسبلين امبنجمنت اجين
The yani, I'm sorry that I didn't explain the pathology of the slipped capital femoral epiphysis well because I one of our colleagues, I don't remember his name, he has already presented yani, what I believe as a comprehensive topic lecture about the issue in one of your webinars. But major pathology of capital femoral epiphysis is that they that you have a posterior and downward displacement of the head over the neck. So what happens is that two things. You have the pump, the anterior pump. When you do internal rotation, the anterior pump will impinge on the edge of the acetabulum. And smoothens with time, this pump will not impinge, but will be included in the range of motion. So when you do excessive internal rotation and the pump has remodeled, the part of the metaphysis become articulating with the articular surface of the hip. So if you have bone articulated with cartilage, that's pre-arthritic. So if you have an early slip with a pump anterior that is coming to the edge of the acetabulum, blocking to the movement, blocking the movement and causing damage to the labrum, this is an impaction type of impingement. But if this pump is smoothened by time and you get more motion and the metaphysis re-articulates with the cartilage of the acetabulum, this is an inclusion type of impingement. So there are two mechanisms for impingement. We have impaction impingement and inclusion impingement. And the most important thing is that even if you relieve this impingement in moderate and severe cases, you still have the posterior, the top cartilage of the head articulating on the part of the hip. So you need to this thick cartilage of the head with the weight-bearing dome of the acetabulum. So that's the reorientation procedure that we do with extra-articular osteotomy.
Dr. Mahmoud, سؤال مني أنا لو تكرمت. From your experience, neglected cases بتاع chronic severe slippage.
Yes.
أفضل طريقة للcorrection احنا طبعا زي ما حضرتك قلت بنبعد قدر الامكان عن النك عشان الليفاسكولار نكروزس بالنسبه للتركاتريك اوستيوتومي هل حضرتك ليك تريكس خاصه ولا جاست الاكستنشن فالجاس روتيشن حسب الديجري او السيفيريتي اوف ديفورميتي ار ان
يس ثانك يو دكتور احمد فور ذا كويستشن ويل اف يو هاف ا سيفير سليب كابيتال فيمورال ديفيسيس ذات از باي ديفولت از امبنجينج And say forever you don't believe in, and the physis is open, so you can, yes, according to protocol, you can do typical hip dislocation and subcapital realignment. What if Dr. Ahmed, you are not comfortable with the surgical hip dislocation approach? It has a bad reputation, in opinion, and you can still do an intertrochanteric osteotomy with osteochondroplasty, but you need to pin the physis because it is still open. So you add just pinning to the intertrochanteric osteotomy. About the intertrochanteric osteotomy, we do the Hauser technique as we described. We do valgus, external, internal rotation, and flexion. But the flexion never exceeds 60 degrees. We do the classic procedure. The only difference that we do is that we do it in the not the supine position, and we do it after we dislocate the hip. We sublux or dislocate the hip, and trim the head-neck junction, and then from the same approach, we do the intertrochanteric osteotomy. We don't do it from the supine lateral position. We do lateral hip approach. In the lateral position, we sublux the hip by the GANS approach while we are protecting the blood supply. And after doing the osteochondroplasty, we do modified classic Imhauser osteotomy. And then we reattach the trochanter.
تمام تسلم يا فندم. سؤال تاني. It is a must to trim the head neck junction even if you see that you have proper head relocation into the establishment.
As I told you, sir, this depends on the degree. If you have a moderate to severe degree and you do a trimming to the head neck junction, you will trim too much. And yes. You want to do intertrochanteric osteotomy alone, the intertrochanteric osteotomy cannot exceed a 60 degrees or 50 degrees flexion. In severe cases, we do a test intraoperative, and 100% of cases you have residual impingement. But the of intertrochanteric osteotomy is you don't have to trim too much after the osteotomy. You need to trim a little bit, and the rest is done by the intercostal osteotomy. But there is always residual impingement, even if to the maximum angle intertrochanteric osteotomy.
And if you آخر جملة حضرتك قلتها دي
if you are not
آخر جملة حضرتك قلتها
this approach, you can simply do a lateral in the supine position, do an intertrochanteric osteotomy, then use a mini hip approach just to trim the residues of the neck.
تمام. دكتور عماد يكمل أسئلة معنا.
تمام يا فندم. هو في بس سؤال أعتقد الدكتور محمود رد عليه اللي هو لو هنعمل osteochondroplasty والاستيوتوم سيشن إيه هو البيشنت بوزيشن وهل محتاجين فراكشر تيبل ولا لا؟
زي ما أنا قلت أنا بكرر الإجابة هو التراديشنال احنا عندنا تو سكولز ان اور ديبارتمنت مثلا اور دير بروفيسور دكتور طارق حسن بيعمل ايه بيعمل سوباين بوزيشن وداوت تراكشن تيبل اند هي ابروتشز ذا هيب لاترالي ثرو ذا واتشون زونز ابروتش سو هي ابروتش ذا اوستيوكوندروبلاستي اند انترتروكانتيريك اوستيوتومي ثرو ذا واتشون زونز ابروتش ذاتس هاو دكتور طارق حسن بريفيرز بيكوز هي دازنت لايك تو دو سيرجيكال هيب ديسلوكيشن وايل ذا اذر تيم We do a lateral position, it's much easier. We do the GANS approach. We sublux the hip, trim the knee partially, and then we do a trochanteric osteotomy, reattach the trochanter, and that's it. And we don't use a fracture table. So there are different things. You can use two approaches. You can use position and do a lateral approach for the intertrochanteric osteotomy, and do an anterior Smith-Peterson approach for the osteochondroplasty, whatever you like. There are different ways of doing the same things as long as you treat impingement, you stop the progression, and you correct the deformity.
تمام دكتور محمود.
في معك أسئلة تانية دكتور عماد؟
لا مفيش يا دكتور أحمد.
أنا شايف في دكتورة هاجر ريزنج هاند يا ريت تكتب لنا السؤال
بتاعها. هو أنا دخلت برايفت شات بس هي تقريبا مش موجودة دلوقتي.
تمام. أنا شايف الدكتورة نريمان نورتنا. أهلا وسهلا بيك يا فندم.